Praise the Lord.
Mukama omulungi yebazibwe.
We thank God for the opportunity to come to you with the word of God.
Twebaza Mukama Katonda olw'omukisa guno okujja gy'oli n'ekigambo kya Katonda.
Let us pray.
Katusabe.
As we start to share.
Nga tutandika okugabana.
Father, we thank you for this time.
Kitaffe twagala okwebaza olw'akaseera kano.
Thank you for the power of God.
Tukwebaza olw'amaanyi go.
Which is available.
Agamanya agaliwo.
To those who depend on you.
Eri abo abakunyumirizaamu.
Father, we lean upon you. Holy Spirit, we lean upon you. And we ask that your power goes forth and touches your people's hearts as your word goes forth. Thank you, Lord our God. Be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amina.
Praise the Lord. Over the time of my life and whatever ministry the Lord has enabled me to bring to people. Over the time that I have been living and walking with the Lord. One of the major burdens that God has put on my heart is a burden for the church. For the church to be taught. To be admonished in the ways of God, and that it may rise to its full potential. Because God has a certain glory He wants the church to
work
in. But there is a way in which we operate many times way below what He intended for us. And so, over the last few weeks, the Lord has been speaking to my heart about stirring up the church. To stir ourselves up to reach our fullness of what God has. You see, the Bible says in Ephesians 3:10 that God intended that His manifold wisdom, His many-sided wisdom, that the way He displays it is in many ways. Yes, so He wants that wisdom of His. He wants it to be demonstrated through the church. He wants to show it through the church. So He has a certain agenda for the church. He has an agenda for the church. And one of those is that the church will be the place where God's power, God's wisdom, where it will be demonstrated. That is how the world will know who God is. But you see, for us to enter into that, there are certain mindsets God wants to remove. There are certain things God wants to deal with. He wants to remove certain mindsets and put a new and different mindset. A different way of thinking. Yes, a different way of thinking. So God wants us to come to those certain realization of the truth. So that we can be able to bring forth His wisdom. And to demonstrate it. And the beauty about what He says in Ephesians, He's not saying you're just demonstrating it to the world. He says He's going to demonstrate to the principalities and powers and rulers. So in other words, Satan is going to see that he is foolish. If the church can walk in the fullness of the wisdom of God, Satan basically will continually be defeated when the church walks in the fullness of God's wisdom. So today, this is one of the things we are going to be talking about. It is a change of our thinking. And the theme of the message today is of a truth, of a truth, mazima dala dala. God is no respecter of persons. Now, when that is the title, of a truth, God is no respecter of persons. Now, when we hear that statement, naturally, we begin to question, but really? Because we are used to people. And the way they look at people based on your profile, their titles. Yes, they are, you know, maybe we look at them based on their family background. Or maybe because of, you know, what the social group around us says about them. So, humanly speaking, we are respectful of persons. We are respecters of persons. So it is very hard to conceptualize this statement
to
understand this statement that God is no respecter of persons. Because we are like, no, me, whenever I see someone, I understand them as so a doctor, so and so. Or pastor, so and so. Or he studied up to this level. Or maybe he's married, his social status in the community is different because he's married. So it's very hard for us to conceptualize how someone can be there and look at people without looking at those things. But I want to say today's title is of a truth. God is no respecter of persons. He is no respecter of persons. Let us go to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. Verse 34. We are going to read just that verse for now. Tugenda kusoma ekyawandiikibwa ekyo. It says, then Peter began to speak.
Awo Petero n'ayasamya akamwa ke.
I now realize.
N'agamba nti mazima ntegedde.
How true it is.
Ntegedde.
That God does not show favoritism.
Katonda tasosola mu bantu.
He said, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism. I want you to know whom we are talking about here. This is
Peter.
Remember that Peter had been walking with Jesus. He had lived with him on earth. He had understood the ways of Jesus. He was there when Jesus was taken up to heaven. He had even been the first one to share the word on the day of Pentecost. So this is a man whom you would think already knew God well. He knew him well. But he makes a statement here which begins to provoke my thinking. He says, I now realize. It's like my eyes have now been opened. It's like I have now got a certain revelation that God does not show favoritism.
So if Peter, it could take him that long to get, if it took him that long, that length of time walking with God, before he could get this realization, before it became so real to him, before he said, I now realize, it means there are maybe many of us in the church. There may be many of us who for many years have walked with God. But we've not yet come to this realization. And because of that the limitation of our way of thinking, we limit God. We limit what God wants to do. And this was the case with Peter. You see, when Peter was saying these words, I want you to realize where he was. He was at the home of a Gentile. So he was at the home of someone who is not a Jew. Which is not appropriate, by the way. According to the laws of Israel, he was not supposed to be there. But he's saying this at the home of Cornelius. And he's saying, you know what? I have just come to this realization that God is no respecter of persons. So it dawned on him while he was at that home. And you know, let me tell you, that was the beginning of the gospel going out to the Gentile world. I want to make a statement here. When God wants to open new boundaries, when he wants to open new boundaries and break frontiers and create, okay, to break frontiers, he has to bring certain revelation. He brings revelation. And this is what happened to Peter. Because until that time, the church was only preaching to the Jews. It was only among the Jews. And yet Jesus had died for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles. But the gospel couldn't go to the other ones because some people were still thinking in a limited way. So whenever God wants to do a new thing, he has to bring new revelation. And that's exactly what happened to Peter at this point. He said, I now realize that God is no respecter of persons. Now, prophetically speaking, I believe that God wants to do some new things with the church. But he has to deal with our thinking in order to release us into a new place. You see, the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, this has been our theme scripture this year, enlarge the place of your tent. It says, you know, break the area where you were limited. Lengthen your cords. Lengthen your cords. Gazia, and strengthen your stakes. Gazia, yes, because God is saying, I want you to break out. Exactly. So he has to deal with our mindset. Now I want to show you a bit of Peter's mindset. So that you understand. Peter was limited by his experiences. You see, first of all, Peter was one of those who was picked by Jesus.
Jesus
came and said, Peter, come and follow me. So probably, I mean, I'm just thinking, it doesn't say it anywhere. It doesn't say it in the Bible. But probably Peter was thinking, maybe I'm special. Because I mean Jesus came and chose me. He picked me out of the others. So maybe he had a feeling, you know, I'm more special. I don't know. I'm not saying that maybe Peter was wrong to think this, because even me, in a normal life, sometimes we look and we say, okay, maybe there is something special that God has. And that is, he picked me. So we think of ourselves in that light sometimes. And that is what Peter was thinking, I think. The other thing about Peter, from church history, it says that Peter was among the older ones of the disciples of Jesus. He was not bakadde like an elder, but bakadde like he was older, physically older. Among the disciples, not in the church, but among the disciples. So probably he thought of himself specially, I am a bit more mature and a bit wiser. I have a bit more wisdom, maybe. So he was older among the disciples. The other thing about Peter, if you read Luke chapter 9 verse 20, this is the time when Jesus asked, whom do men say that I am? Whom do people say I am? And then they told him, you know, the Messiah. I mean, they said the prophets of old, Elijah, etc. Then he said, but you, whom do you say I am? And Peter was this one man. He's the one who got the revelation. And he said, you are the Christ. You are the Son of God. So probably in his mind, he thought, okay, God has given me a certain privilege of getting revelation. Yes, because when he discovered it, Jesus said, that has not been revealed to you by flesh and blood. So probably he had a certain feeling, I'm among the older disciples. Jesus picked me.
Yes,
on top of that, I even got revelation of who the Christ is. And what is interesting, that even after that time, after he had got that revelation, the way the story is told in the book of Matthew chapter 16, it's actually the same story about how Peter got the revelation
actually,
of who Jesus was.
But
they tell us the other part of the story right after that revelation. You see, he heard Jesus saying, now I'm going to die. I'm, you know, talking about the fact that he was going to die. Then he said, he called him aside, said, first wait. He called Jesus aside. Peter called Jesus.
Okay, Peter, Peter, naita Yesu.
Yeah, and then he said, you first come aside.
Here.
And he said, let me correct. Let me correct you a bit. So I'm trying to look at all these things to say, maybe this is why Peter maybe felt he had a certain special place. So maybe he had begun to think that, you know, God maybe doesn't deal with others the same way as he deals with
us. Yes,
so maybe you are thinking, maybe God works with certain people more than others. So maybe God has a certain is a respecter of persons.
Asosola.
And sometimes we can, from our experiences, we can begin to have these kind of thoughts. Some people have the thoughts like the ones of Peter. But there are others who have another mindset. The one of, okay, God chooses those people. Not me.
Sinze.
And that is also a mindset which is not accurate. Because Peter, when he got this revelation, he says, I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism. Let us look at another story from the book of Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 9. This is the story of Samuel and Saul.
Samuel and Saul.
I'm laboring to talk about these things because I believe that God wants to have a certain change in our mindset so that we may enter into experiencing the fullness of what God has for the church. So let us look at verse 1 and verse 2. 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1.
Okay.
So I've just painted for you the picture of possibly what Peter might have been thinking before that day. Before that day when he got this revelation. By the way, even about Peter, Jesus said, you are the rock, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. So really, there was a way in which he was a special person, right? So maybe he had now gotten to a point where he was thinking, maybe God has a certain respect for certain people more than others. Favorites. God, I just want to say God has no favorites. God has no favorites. He doesn't have people he loves more than others. He doesn't love me more than you. He doesn't love pastor more than someone else. It's not like that. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1. It says there was a Benjamite, a man of standing, whose name was Kish. Son of Abiel, son of Zero, the son of Becharoth, the son of Afia.
Mutabani wa Zezololi, mutabani wa Bekolasi.
Yes.
Mutabani wa Fia
of Benjamin.
Omwana ombenjamini.
Listen to verse 2. He had a son named Saul.
Era yalina omwana erinya lye Saulo.
An impressive young man.
Omulenzi omulungi.
Without equal.
So mubana omulenzi omulungi so mubana ba Israeli.
A head taller than any of the others.
Twali muntu eyali amusinga obulungi.
So you can hear they describe for you Saul. First of all, Kish was a man of standing. He was a significant man, isn't it? Secondly, Saul himself was better than actually over all the Israelites. That's what they say. Now let us go on and look at verse 14. I've skipped some of the verses in the interest of time. I'll tell you the rest of that story. It says in verse 14, they went up to the town. As they were entering it, there was Samuel coming toward them on his way up to the high place. Verse 15, now the day before Saul came, the Lord had revealed this to Samuel. Verse 15. Verse 16. About this time tomorrow, I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin.
Nti encha mchisera chino, nawe reza jori omusajia ava musia Benjamin.
Anoint him leader over my people Israel. He will deliver my people from the hand of the Philistines. Mafuta,
okuba omukuru w'abantu bange mu Isiraeli.
He will deliver my people from the hand of the Philistines. I have looked upon my people, for their cry has reached me.
Kubanga nuride abantu bange kubanga kaba kwabwe kuntu kutuse jendi.
Verse 17. When Samuel caught sight of Saul, the Lord said to him, "This is the man I spoke to you about. He will govern my people."
Yalaba Saulo mukama namugamba ntiraba omusajja gwenakugambieko oyo
Verse 18, Saul approached Samuel in the gateway and asked, "Would you please tell me where the seer's house is?"
Awo Saulo n'asemberera Samueli mu mulyango n'ayogera nti, "Mbulira nkwegayidde enyumba y'omulabi weri."
Verse 19, "I am the seer," Samuel replied. "Go up ahead of me to the high place, for today you are to eat with me, and in the morning I will let you go and will tell you all that is in your heart."
Samuel nadamu Saulo nayogera nti nze mulabi yambuka okukulembera mu kifo ekigulumivu kubanga munalya nange leero.
Let's keep going. Verse 20. "As for the donkeys you lost 3 days ago, do not worry about them. They have been found. And to whom is all the desire of Israel turned, if not to you and all your father's family?"
Olwabiri. Nendogo izo ezakamala ennaku satu okubula. Tozeralikirira. Kubanga zirabise. Erabyo na ebyogebebwa mu Isiraeli. Biriba byani. Tebiriba bibyo. Gwe nenyumba ya kitawo yonna.
Okay. Now verse 21, I want you to hear. Saul answered, "But I am not a Benjamite." No, but am I not a Benjamite from the smallest tribe of Israel?
Saul nadamu nayogera nti inze siri mu Benjamin owomuchika ekisinga obutono mu bika bya Israeli.
And is not my clan the least of all the clans of the tribe of Benjamin?
Ne nyumba yange si yesinga obutono mu nyumba zonna ezekika kya Benjamin.
Why do you say such a thing?
Kale kiki ekikwogeza nange bwotyo?
Praise the Lord.
Mukama,
so we are seeing, they first describe for you who Saul was. They explain to you, he's first of all, he's from a family where the father is a notable man. Number two, whoever was writing this, I don't know who they are, but they said Saul was the most handsome or the tallest and the most handsome and I don't know what in Israel. So they've described him to you. But look at Saul. When he meets Samuel. Now God is talking to Samuel and saying, "I am sending you someone whom you are going to anoint
king."
Just to make it clear, God doesn't speak based on Saul's looks. No, he's not making his decision to choose Saul on the basis of his looks. No, he has just chosen Saul. That is, God just chose Saul. And he said, "This is the one I have picked." But now, Saul, God has created him with capacity. He has even put him in a family where there is capacity. But look at the mind of Saul. The mind of Saul is reflected in verse 21. He says, "But am I not a Benjamite from the smallest tribe of Israel? And is not my clan the least of all the clans of the tribe of Benjamin? Why do you say such a thing to me?" So he's looking at himself smaller than God actually intended for him to
be.
God has created him with capacity. But he's looking at himself from his own perspective. And this is exactly what is going on in the mind of this man, Saul.
yalina mu bwongo bwa Sawulo.
So Saul is busy limiting God.
Ye yali agezaako kulaba nga Mukama Katonda
by his way of thinking.
Ngagezaako okuteeka ekomo ku Katonda.
Even though God has put capacity in him.
Nenga te Mukama namutaddemu obusobozi bwe.
But now he is instead looking at himself and saying I'm from the smallest clan.
Nenga te atansogama ntinze munnago ndaba nva mu kike kitono.
No, first of all he says I'm from the smallest tribe. Remember Benjamin is the last tribe.
Atajukira gama ntinze nva mu kike kitono.
The last tribe.
Mu kike kitono.
And secondly the smallest clan.
Ate kika kitono.
The other one is tribe.
Eh egwanga. It's okay, riba de gwanga.
He says I'm from a tribe which is the least in Israel.
Tono, elisinga dale tono mu Israel.
And then on top of that I'm even from the smallest clan in that tribe.
So
Saul's perspective.
Kankati Saul okutegera kwa Saul
is still in a certain way. And some of us, God is calling us to do things and to break frontiers. God is saying, I want to anoint you. But we are limiting God by saying, you see, for me, I am from this kind of family. You know, I cannot be among the real estate owners in Kampala. Exactly, because you are looking at yourself in a certain perspective. So this is an interesting different way of looking at yourself. The first one was like Peter, where maybe he's thinking there is a way in which I'm special. God has chosen me. I am this. And then we have a soul who is busy saying, no, I am, you know, from the least tribe and the least clan. Exactly. And yet he has all the capacity because God has created him with it. And I want to say to you, by the way, this way of thinking also, it also has a problem. Because you see, it costs Saul. It is what cost Saul the kingdom also. Yes, because you see, at first he was looking at himself as small. And then when he became a king, he now thought he's defined by his position. thought now he was very important. Because you see, he was estimating himself based on his position at any given time.
I want to say
to you, go see yourself the way God sees you. Don't look at yourself the way you are. Some people have not seen what God has in store for you. Some people have not yet seen the capacity that you have for the transformation of nations. But when God calls and anoints, I'm telling you, your story will become a totally different story. So don't look at yourself and look at yourself in your limitations. Of a truth, God is no respecter of persons. Of a truth, God is no respecter of persons. Of a truth, God is no respecter of persons. God doesn't look at your background. God doesn't look at, you know, your qualifications to determine which things he wants to do with you. The Bible says, no eye has seen. No ear has heard. It has not even come into the minds of men, the things that God has prepared for you. You see Saul, because of looking at himself based on his current circumstances, when he became a king, he started looking at himself as big. And because he thought he was so big, God gave an instruction and said, do this. He decided to do something else. They told him, when you enter this city, you destroy everything that you find there. He said, no, me, I will take some and make them an offering. He decided to do what he thought was now right. Because he was seeing himself in the capacity of where he
was.
So, brethren,
Abo Luganda,
friend,
Abo Mikwano Jange,
see yourself the way God sees you. God is no respecter of persons. I said God is no respecter of persons. It is people who look at themselves in based on their circumstances. Those people, those kind of people are the ones who end up in rebellion to God. Because that's exactly what Samuel told Saul. If you read 1 Samuel chapter 15 verse 23. Yes, from that you can read from verse 17 to verse 23. But he said that rebellion is like the sin of witchcraft. And then he even hinted and said, pride and arrogance. Arrogance is pride. It's a type, it's like demonstrating pride. Exactly. Now, that is what Saul ended up with. Because he was seeing himself based on those circumstances. Now, let us move on to 1 Samuel chapter 16. And we read another experience about this perspective. Let's read verse 5. It says, Samuel replied, yes, in peace I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me. Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons. And he invited them to the sacrifice. Listen to verse 6. Very interesting. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. Now I want you to remember Samuel. When Saul appeared, the first time when Saul appeared, I'm sure when Samuel saw Saul, I mean the Bible says that Saul was taller than all the other Israelites. It says he was more good looking than
them.
So I think when Samuel saw him the first time, that experience remained in his mind. It remained in his mind. Yes. So this time when he comes to the house of Jesse, and God has sent him to anoint someone from there. Because God had now rejected Saul and he wanted a new king. So when Samuel arrived at Jesse's house, you see, this is what it says in verse 6. When they arrived, when the children of Jesse came, what does it say? Samuel saw Eliab. Eliab was the firstborn of Jesse. So he was the big one, the one more in control.
The
one in charge of things. So Samuel, this is what it says, he thought. In his mind.
Samuel narowoza mundowoza.
Yes, surely the Lord's anointed stands here. So immediately he began to remember the soul experience.
Amazima amangwago najukira engeri weyalinga.
ayiwakwamafuta ku Saul. Aha, he remembered how Saul was tall, how well composed he was. And I think he thought, whoa, now this is the Lord's anointed. I've got another one who is like the other Saul. Listen to verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height. For I have rejected him. Listen, the Lord does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance. But the Lord looks at the heart. But the Lord looks at the heart. I want you to read, let's read verse 11. So Samuel asked Jesse, are these all the sons you have? I think now, Samuel now had learnt, I think when the Lord reminded him. He reminded him, he said, you see, by the way, last time I'm the one who told you that Saul was coming. So please don't assume that Eliab is the one. You wait for me to tell you who the one is. So they brought the second one, God said not that one. Third one, God said not that one. So when they had finished almost all of them, then this one asked, but are these all the sons you have? Now listen, they are still the youngest. Jesse answered, but he's tending the sheep. Aha. Samuel said, send for him. We will not sit down. Yes. So he sent and had him brought in. And he was ruddy with a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, rise and anoint him. He's the one. So Samuel had now also learned. So you can imagine he's here almost towards the end of his life also. Just like Peter, who has been with the Lord for a long time. And then it occurs to him. He realizes, oh, God does not look at the outside. Of the truth, God is no respecter of
persons.
So me, I'm busy seeing people who are listening in or people who are watching. I want you to know God has certain capacities he has put in you. And it is not because you are better than anyone. It is not because like Peter, you were the chosen one, you are the rock, you are this. Neither is it because of your family background, like Saul's family background. Nor is it because you are the last born like David. That is why God is choosing you. But I want you to realize God is no respecter of persons. God is no respecter of persons. God is no respecter of persons. There are many stories of people who were looking at themselves from their perspective. And God just had to show them no. Gideon is one.
Gideon,
he was, if you read in Judges chapter 6, in Judges chapter 6. He was there quietly in a hidden place threshing wheat. And the angel of God came to call him to one being, to be a warrior. Some of you, God is calling you to be warriors. He's calling you to be warriors in the kingdom. But you are thinking like Gideon. Gideon also said, I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. I'm also from the small clan. God doesn't look at
Mukama tala babe, yo.
Praise the Lord.
Mukama yebazi.
Praise the Lord.
Mukama yebazi.
Praise the Lord.
Yebazi.
So I want to point out 5 key things.
That
we need to walk by. If we are going to do exploits for God. Like I told you before, my burden most of my life the burden I feel God has put upon me
is
that the church would realize what God wants to do through us. That you will understand. That you will realize. That you will come to a revelation of it. And when you get that revelation, you will do exploits. Because the Bible says in the book of Daniel that those who know their God, they shall be strong and they shall do exploits. This is the time when God wants us to enter into accomplishment of incredible exploits. But many of us are still limited by our way of thinking. And that is why God is bringing this word and is saying, of a truth, God is no respecter of persons. He does not select based on your background, he can pick someone who has been trained in, I don't know, in engineering, and take him and put him in farming and do exploits there. Because God is no respecter of persons. He can pick a one doctor like me and say, I want you to go and preach. No theology. No background of those theology things. But God is no respecter of persons. God can pick a mere child like David. And he can make him overthrow giants like Goliath. Because God is no respecter of persons. God can pick mere fishermen like Peter and John, and he turns them into the rock on which he builds his church. Because God is no respecter of persons. God doesn't respect persons. God does what he wants to do. But he must find a man who realizes these things. This is the only way the gospel was able to go into the Gentile world. It had to come to the realization of Peter. Peter had to realize, of the truth, God is no respecter. He is no respecter of persons. So what should we do in order to align ourselves with God? Number one, believe what the written word says. Whatever is in this book, which God has said about you, which he has said about you, it is true. It is true. There is no lie in it. The Bible says we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Not because of our power. Not because of our might. Not because of our wisdom. But we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. I want you to wake up in the morning and tell yourself, I am more than a conqueror. I want you to face the giants of your life and say, I am more than a conqueror. I am going to do more than you can imagine. Because I am more than a conqueror. Through him that loved me. Yes, through him that loved me. You see, God wants to demonstrate his power. But he wants to demonstrate it in earthen vessels like you and me. He wants to use people, human beings like you and me. Limited people whom people look at and say, this one cannot do this. This one cannot be a billionaire. No, you can be a billionaire. Yes, because God can demonstrate his power through you. So that he can provide resources for the advancement of the kingdom of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Don't look down upon yourself.
But
also don't look highly upon yourself on the basis of your achievements. Because God is no respecter of persons. Believe what the written word of God says. If there is anything which has helped me in life, it is believing these things. Believing these words. It is what has provoked me to go all the way. To do whatever God has called me to do. It is believing these things. The Bible says in Romans 12, verse 2, it says that be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be transformed. You can be a different man. You can be a totally different person. If you choose today, you can be a different person. Your address can change. Your life can totally change. God can perform mighty miracles through you. If only you will believe. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Number two, seek guidance from the Lord. Seek guidance from the Lord. Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. This is just before Peter said, I now realize that God is no respecter of persons. In verse 19 of Acts chapter 10, it says, while Peter was still thinking about the vision, let me just give you maybe a little preamble. You see, Peter was at someone's home. And he was waiting to eat food. He was hungry. Then suddenly he had a vision. And God showed him a sheet coming from heaven. And it came down with animals of all kinds. And it had among them those animals that the Israelites used to consider unclean. And then he heard God's voice saying, Peter, you get up and kill and eat. Now, some people have used this to apply to eating some of these animals now. Because they use this scripture. But really, God was trying to show Peter something. So verse 19, it says, while Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, Simon, Three men are looking for you. And then, you know, so verse 20, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them. For I have sent them. So Peter got his guidance. This was one of the key things that led him to take the gospel into the Gentile world. That's what I'm saying, that if God is going to use us to do exploits, we've said number one, believe what the written word says. Number two, seek guidance from the Lord. Seek guidance. This is exactly what Samuel had also. Whenever he was walking, he was saying, Lord, what are you saying? Even though at first he saw Eliab and he thought, this is the Lord's anointing. But then he had the guidance of the Lord. So seek guidance from the Lord. Let me tell you, seek guidance from the Lord. It will take you places. It will cause you to accomplish great things in the kingdom. Number three, it's in verse 28 of this same chapter. Verse 28, he said to them, you are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. Don't be bound by the laws of men. Don't be bound by the laws of men. Don't be bound by the laws of men. That is what Peter did, realized. When God showed him, then he realized, okay, God is saying to me, I shouldn't consider these Gentiles unclean. Some of you, God is saying, now I want you to go into, say, agriculture. And you are saying, but how can a doctor be in agriculture? The laws of men. The laws of men. Some of you, God is saying, you know, I want you to go into business. And for you, you are like, but me, I only do jobs. It was a salary that I am supposed to get. Not business. I don't know how to do those things. Being bound by the laws of men. If you are going to enter into new frontiers, if you are going to enter into new places and accomplish kingdom exploits, don't be bound by the laws of men. Number three. Number four. Verse 29. Let's read it. So when I was sent for, this is Peter speaking.
Chapter 10, verse 29.
So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask why you sent for me? You hear this man, Peter. What do you hear inside that question? Humility. Humility. Be humble. Be humble. If you are going to accomplish exploits in the world, be humble. Because Peter said, so when I was sent for,
hey, we want Peter.
I came.
Naja.
So Cornelius sent for Peter.
Cornelius yamuita.
And Peter just went.
Na agenda, Petero, na agenda.
And when he reached there,
okay.
He didn't come and say, I am the rock. upon which God will build his church. No. He said, may I ask why you sent for me? Hey, why did you call me? He did come announcing himself. He just came.
Humble.
If you're going to accomplish incredible things, be humble. The Bible says God exalts the humble. But he humbles the proud. Finally, number five. This one is an interesting one. I want you to listen to what Cornelius said from verse
30.
Cornelius answered, 4 days ago, I was in my house praying at this hour, at 3 in the afternoon. Suddenly, a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest in the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. Who lives by the sea. Verse 33. So I sent for you immediately. And it was good of you to come. Now we are all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us. What am I trying to bring out? This is point number 5. Listen for God's answers to men's prayers. Listen, okay, let me read it, then you try to interpret it. Listen for God's answers to men's prayers. Try to hear the way God is trying to answer the prayers of people. And ask God how you may be part of the answer. You see, Cornelius was praying for a long time. And God finally decides to answer Cornelius. But Peter was positioned to be part of the answer to Cornelius' prayer. When God spoke to Peter, he didn't say, "Ah, God, you send John. you send James to go to..." No. Peter was paying attention to hear how can I be part of God's answer to his prayers. In other words, how can I be part of the solution? I want you to ask yourself, how can you be part of the solution? Exactly. How can I be a part of the answer of God to people's needs? I'm not very good in Uganda, but ngenda kuba ntia ekitundu kukudiwamu kwa Katonda eri esala z'abantu. Maybe this is what I'm trying to say. How am I going to be part of the answer? So go back to your community and ask God, how can I be part of your answer to this community? If people need prayer, can I be part of the prayer team? Can I be part of the prayer team? Not part of those who are looking for prayer. but how can I be part of the prayer? How can I be part of the answer? If people need prayer, can I be part of the prayer team? If Uganda right now is looking for value-added products, can I be part of the people who are producing value-added products? When I say value-added, I'm saying not selling coffee beans, but selling coffee that it's ground and already packed. Instead of just bringing my beans and saying, let them also be sold. Thank you. How can I be part of the answer of God to people's problems? Thank you very much. If you understand that, then I can tell you the truth. Of the truth, God will use you. Of the truth, God will use you to answer people's prayers. And that is how you will become great. That is how you will accomplish exploits. You will do it because you are listening to God to see how you can be an answer. Yes, so that you can be an answer to people's prayers. And I want to tell you, there are so many questions in the world. There are so many problems in the world. If you will choose to be part of the answer, God will do incredible things. Now, we need to bring it to an end. In the interest of time, praise the Lord. But I want you to remember of a truth. God is no respecter of persons. He doesn't respect persons. And he will use you if you will decide to follow these 5 principles. Believe what the written word says. Seek guidance from the Lord. Don't be bound by the laws of men. Break into new frontiers where you've never, where things have not been done before. Four, be humble. And number five, listen for God's answers to men's prayers. Exactly, so that you are part of God's answer to people's prayers. And God will do glorious things with you if you will realize that he's no respecter of persons. If we had enough time, I would give you testimony after testimony. But I have seen God, when I've been following these principles, for instance, when COVID came, I heard that people in Burundi, they needed like some of these masks to help protect people. And we were in Kampala. I thought, but will we, Burundi is very far, Bujumbura. But I thought people need to be protected. So I prayed and I felt God was saying, it's okay, you be part of the solution. So we decided to venture, find, by then it was, I think, one truck in the whole of Kampala which was going to Burundi. And it would go twice a week. So we decided to partner with some people who manufacture masks and send some to Burundi. And out of that business in Burundi, we've earned so much money in the COVID season while it's also a difficult time. It's also a difficult time. But because of saying, God, we believe that you can give us victory, we are going to step out by faith. We are going to listen for your guidance. We are going to trust you. And then we are going to look for a way to be answers to people's problems. God has given us victory in that area. In a time of difficulty. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I just wanted to give one testimony so that people don't say, okay, we are hearing the words, but we don't see the practical. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Praise God. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. May you cause your church to shine. May you cause your church to arise. May you help us to realize what you've called us to be and what you've called us to do in the world at this time. Help us not to look down on ourselves. Help us also not to be so high-minded that we think we are so important. Help us to keep in perspective. Help us to keep the right perspective so that we may accomplish great exploits in the kingdom of God. Thank you, Father. Lord, I prophesy over your people that greatness comes into their lives, that revelation comes to them, that wisdom comes to them, that understanding comes to them, that knowledge comes to them, that, Lord, many are going to be totally transformed because of these words that you've spoken to us. That, Lord, people will testify and say, I started this business when I heard that word. People will say, I started preaching in my community and many have gotten saved because of that word. It challenged me to rise up. Father, let your power go forth and lift your people up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.